day.
Folks, this is just a swap, this is not a disposal.
I'm happy to move it.
Oh, second.
Yeah, I second because, you know, you've been here all day.
Who seconded, who's moving?
I'll move.
Councillor Hulse, seconded by...
Oh, Mr Hills, Mr Hill.
Paul, do you wish to say anything? We take it as read.
Straight. No, it's already been to the Environment and Community Committee.
It doesn't make any difference.
No, it doesn't make any difference at all.
Okay, but we have no one who's putting their hand up to question this, so... All those in favour?
Aye.
Against? Thank you, thank you.
Just your mere presence is enough for comments, I have to say.
It's a long wait.
Right, we're now moving to item number 12.
Ever going to get their hours back?
See ya.
Going away.
Given up.
I'll pass my coro to you, David.
That's all right. I'll help make the call.
What's the story?
Is it home time for you? Hang on, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
We'll have a forum, yep.
These are just the letters of expectation.
Yep.
Please.
Fruit, yeah.
Just long enough here to cause havoc and then they go away.
John, John.
Alistair.
Yes, exactly.
Thank you, Mr Chair.
It's just a crew here.
Okay, come on, vote Sarah and Alistair have undivided attention.
I'll just do a very brief introduction to the letters of expectation here and also I'd like to introduce the wonderful Sarah Holdham, who's been doing the work on this. I'm not sure some of you may have met Sarah during the Government's Framework Review work. Just to put a bit of context around this, letters of expectation is an annual letter that Council sends to the CCOs in order to guide the preparation of their statements of intent. Also sort of set some expectations around behaviour and operations and service delivery as well as their work programmes for the coming years. I think just to put the role of this committee clearly in context, the terms of reference of this committee are to recommend the contents of the letters of expectation to the Mayor. It'll be the Mayor that'll and mayoral staff who'll prepare the final letters and send them out to the CCOs. We haven't attached draft letters to the report, rather that we've sort of concentrated on themes to be addressed within the letters so that we don't actually get into wordsmithing the letters here, but rather make sure that we're attacking the right issues. Probably should also point out that obviously we're in the middle of an LTP process and the funding decisions made in that LTP will have a great bearing on what we expect our CCOs to do. An obvious example would be Panuku, depending on the level of funding that they receive through the LTP, very much impacts what they're able to do in the way of urban regeneration. We'll get Sarah to work through the sort of key messages that we've pulled out. We've developed these key messages by working with staff from across council as well as sitting down at times with the chairs of the committees of the whole and the mayoral office and others around the organisation. We've split it into some common organisational expectations and priorities for all of the CCOs and sort of two or three key strategic areas for each CCO. We didn't put into our report an endless list of priorities. If everything is a priority, nothing is. So we're trying to focus on what are the big issues and also any other things that we think may be important for each of the CCOs. Like I say, we've developed these lists by working with people across the organisation, but we're really here to get your feedback based on previous years' experience. It's often difficult for us to tell if a comment around the table is actually the will of the committee or the voice of an individual councillor. So we'd greatly appreciate if somebody does want to add something that whether we formally vote on it or at least get a good indication from the committee whether that's supported, that would be greatly appreciated on our part.
Do you not have that
trouble
too?
And look, that might do it for me by way of introduction, unless there are any questions at this stage. Otherwise, I'll hand over to Sarah.
Straight on to Sarah.
Thank you, Alistair. Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I will touch on the common expectations first, and these are contained in the cover paper. So as Alistair said, there are three main areas of common expectations that we've set out in the paper. And the first is around sending a message of financial accountability. As you know, we're in a long-term plan process and there are some hard choices that will have to be made. So I think just setting the scene with that general expectation that we want CCOs to be making sure that they're getting the best for every dollar. Beyond that, the second sort of common expectation is around building on the group approach and making sure we're acting, the CCOs are acting in concert as a group, and there are two sort of key aspects to that. The first is around the value for money reviews, which some of them have been completed, and there's obviously a rolling program. So there's two important aspects here is implementing the findings of the recommendations of the existing one once the sort of feasibility of those and timeframes of those have been agreed by the committee, and also sort of participating actively and fully in those current and ones yet to come, reviews yet to come. And the second part of that group approach theme is around group policies and corporate policies. And so, as you are all aware, there have been several group policies that have been developed this year. So the intention is that we set an expectation that CCOs are actively implementing those policies, but as well that they are participating in the ones that are yet to come. So I understand that there's a policy on business cases under preparation. And also a corporate policy framework which the council has been developing, and there are some sort of ongoing negotiations about how that's going to be embedded within the CCOs themselves. And the third kind of key theme of common expectations is around Māori responsiveness. And as you all saw, there was the report earlier today signal that there is still a bit of work to be done, and so we are recommending that the letters send a signal that we expect CCOs to be participating in both that report coming in February, but also reaffirming their commitment to Te Toa Takitini and making sure that they are actively delivering on their obligations to Māori and the Council's Māori responsiveness framework.
Perhaps if we could pause and just take any feedback on those common expectations there. Member Taipuri, I'd just like to, I think at the end of the last statement of intent process, you made some noises about the Te Reo policy. We have put in here or suggested that each of the CCOs assist us to develop a plan for actually implementing that policy. At the moment, we have a policy, and from what I understand, not much in the way of a plan around implementing that. So we want to take that next step to actually rolling that out.
Thank you. I saw that. And I guess the key one that I just didn't quite hear in that, but is in the documentation here in the report, is the emphasis around the collaboration between them all for Māori outcomes. I think there needs that emphasis in the statement of intent. To drive them to work together. I think the one thing I did like, or not one, but one of the things I did like was the focus on avoiding duplication of fora and engagement. I think that's long overdue to bring it all together because the engagement is all over the place in my view. So hopefully with the collaboration and that focus and all the other things that you've listed, that's very good. Well, you're not used to me saying very good.
Sorry, I was here and getting whispered in my left ear. Right.
No one's listening at this time of the day.
I was listening, David.
Apart from Alistair.
And we were stunned to silence. So.
Sorry. Councillor Newman.
Yes, thank you. You've asked for feedback in relation to the common expectations. I'd like to provide some comment specifically on that, and then I do have some questions and comments specifically about water care, Mr. Chair.
Yep.
So my question, my feedback in relation to water care, the 17A review, I have raised the issue with Sally Garrett and her team previously about the role of Veolia in relation to the Three Waters 17A exercise, because Veolia has a franchise agreement for retail water in Papakura and Franklin, actually, a big area of Franklin that is subject to development. And so the 17A review is important in terms of that relationship and Veolia's ability, or currently its inability, to have any input, given that it has retail control. So could you, I'm happy to come back in slower time, but I really do urge some exposure there, because currently what I'm told is that water care will be the sole contributor to the 17A discussions, as evidenced in what we saw from report from Ms. Garrett's team, and that Veolia have absolutely no input whatsoever. It's important that Veolia's views in relation to particularly funding and asset development and asset management have some exposure on the 17A exercise. Okay. And I'm happy to report that in slower time, and I'm happy to talk to the Mayor's Office as well, because that's critically important. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Councillor Casey.
This is just on the common themes, Alistair. None of the ones I'm about to talk about will be of any surprise to you, but still in all, we're, after 7 years, we still need to highlight them, I think. And I'm sure I'm speaking for all my colleagues, but they'll tell you if it's otherwise. The first is the linkage from the CCO back to ratepayers' money. You know, there's still not a month goes by, but I don't sort of weep when I fail to see that recognition in something. It's usually there's a few miscreants, and it would be Auckland Transport, ATEED, and RFA. So that is really, really important to me. That is that we take the reputational risk when they do something wrong, and we should get acknowledgement for the stuff that they are doing well. Instead of them getting it, we should be getting it. So that's the trade-off. So I'm sure it'll be in that common themes section, Alistair, but if it's not, I need to see it back in there, because it's still not working. That's the first one. I've got a wee list, if that's all right. The second one is, one of the things that this council is doing really, really well is diversity. Our diversity strategy is brilliant. Our implementation is rolling out. But I can't say the same for the CCOs. And I think we need to give them a kick up the backside to make sure that they recognise again that that's what we want to see in them. We want to see their face representing the face of Auckland in all its hues, in all its shades, in all its minority groups. And I would like to see that in the common themes, that they have a commitment to diversity. For example, Auckland Council has four rainbow ticks. Okay, that's a start, but there's none of the CCOs have put their hand up for to be recognised for their work with LGBTI communities, and every CCO will have staff members that are of that community. That's just an example. So that was the diversity. David's talked about Te Reo, but I'd just like to reinforce that. You know, Glenn, if Glenn was here, he'd be saying, you know, where's the Maori language on our trains? Where's the Maori language on our buses, on our stations, on our public buildings? And that would also, next to the Pūtikawa, you know, we have the Maori language and the Pūtikawa linked back to ratepayers' money. One that came up recently, which is bothering me, was when Auckland Transport, in its wisdom, approved tobacco advertising on the Pink Path, and the local board had to lead a campaign to get that changed. Now, we have both really good ethical divestment policies. We've also got good partnership, commercial partnerships policies. Just need to reinforce again, when the CCO does something, it's us that takes the risk for it when it goes wrong. Have you? Oh, good.
Yes. in no uncertain terms.
Pathetically.
Well, I think you did well.
Finally, that's it. That's for the common themes. I've got some specific themes when you come on. Oh, no, risk. We had a really good audit and risk meeting recently, and all the CCOs are doing that much, much better. So it's to compliment them on that. I think that I was really impressed by that register that a lot of the CCOs are doing. Really good work. So maybe we can say something nice to them.
Guess we could.
Alistair, could you just, the very first thing that Councillor Casey started with, and then I think she ended with it, I'm not sure, but the juxtaposition of the logo next to the CCO logos, that has been a fairly consistent request from us. And some are doing it better than others, but
yeah. It
is something, and I know it's minor, but it isn't actually minor, it's quite important for many of us.
Well, I don't actually think it is minor, and this is going slightly off the topic of the letters of expectation, but I'm almost wondering whether it needs to be a bit more hands-on, where if we see something that we don't think appropriately recognises Auckland Council's contribution or is in terms of our grand guidelines, that actually I think what needs to happen there is that example needs to be brought to the attention of the chair of the board and sat down with a meeting with everybody's turning to the mayor, so I'll say the mayor, or the deputy mayor, or Councillor Casey, or the like, to point out exactly what it is that we're objecting to. Because we write year after year saying, hey, please appropriately recognise Auckland Council in the funding that you receive from us and the ratepayers of Auckland. I think it is actually just that practical example by example sort of enforcement, if you like, of that issue. Because, look, we keep telling them, we keep getting examples pointed out. I get infrequent but regular emails from Councillor Casey with photos attached showing something that isn't quite right, and we deal with it on a case-by-case basis. And I think that would actually reinforce the message better than anything else.
Can I give an example just recently? These are things that don't come to you. In the town hall, at Requiem for the Street, which was the homeless concert, the presenter said, I'd just like to thank Auckland Live for the use of the town hall. I'm thinking, it's our town hall.
Oh, yeah.
It's Auckland Live, you know? That's just an example. And I will come on to RFA in a minute, but that's one example. You know, it's our town hall. We get the recognition for giving it to people to use free of charge or at low cost.
Okay, I have Councillor Watson, Cooper, Hulse, Darby, and we are getting a bit stretched on a quorum, and the mayor is going in 25 minutes. So
we have no one else
this
to leave.
Is some of the most
Councillor Watson,
the room will be locked after this.
Councillor Watson,
my question was on some of the strategic areas. You don't want to hear them just yet.
Who, out of those people, who wants to talk about the common expectations?
No,
you're not
I'm
even
talk
on
about
the
a
list,
particular Councilor. One. Well, I should have been. I
had
my hand up.
Okay, Councillor Simpson, common expectations.
I'll be brief. And I just want to start by acknowledging the Mayor for your work that you're tightening up with the CCOs. I think this is really good. And the fact that we're really highlighting that they need to be a little bit more accountable. So on the common themes, I would like to potentially talk about delivery. So it's not an expectation, it's a little bit stronger than an expectation, because I've just heard you say, Alistair, that we say year after year and we write this year after year and it doesn't happen. So something tightening around the fact that we don't expect, this is not for the good of our health, we're actually doing this because we really mean it. So something tightening around that. And the second one is a bit about transparency. I think we've always said that we will try as much as possible to keep the CCOs as transparent as possible. So maybe putting that in such a way, weaving it in such a way that it's without making sure it's not sensitive and it can't be released, but as much as possible that we should expect them to be transparent. But those are the two things I would add. And then finally, Your Worship, I know that you have in the final recommendations have the final say. But often in these things, the devil is in the detail. Is it possible for us to potentially have a meeting with you and have a look at, because this is a particular area of expert of interest for me, and I would like to potentially...
Yep. I'm going I'm going to suggest, I've had a discussion with Councillor Darby about involving the chairs of planning and environment and community that deal with the CCO, some of the CCOs. The letters will be done in consultation with them. I'm happy for you to come up and or any other councillor to come up and have a look at the actual letters, if that's helpful.
Councillor Simpson, the finance has been added to that, make it all committees on the whole.
Yeah,
but I'm only deputy, so yeah,
that's okay. That's okay. I'm happy if anybody has a particular interest to come up and have a chat with me or my staff.
I do. Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, I'd like to.
And Kathy.
Email it to me, and I'll just email you back.
Councillor Watson.
Okay, thanks. A couple of specific ones. In terms of RFA, okay, number two, regional stadia strategy.
Oh, sure. Sorry to cut you off, but maybe if we went through CCO by
good idea.
CCO.
Yeah, let's knock them off in order.
Okay.
Could make our life a wee bit easier.
So what we've got Councillor Watson, Cooper, Hulse and Darby, and what we're going to do is we're going to do water care first. So if any of those people want to talk about water care.
I'm water care.
Then
I'm Panuku.
Okay,
so
well.
I'm Ari.
Water care.
All right, water care. So the four key themes that we have, we propose that Watercare should focus on in the letter are the implementing the three waters value for money reviews. So obviously there's a feasibility report to come back in February. We are expecting that Watercare will play a strong leadership role in participating both in that report but obviously in the implementation of its findings, and there are some reasonably substantial things in there. The second is around integrated urban regeneration. So that's a theme that's sort of across four of the CCOs, Panuku, Auckland Transport, Watercare and ATEED. And that is about working together to sort of achieve good urban outcomes in the council's priority areas. So it's a slightly sort of general theme, but something that we are expecting cooperation this year. The third is around the Western Isthmus Water Quality Program, and obviously there's been some progress this year in getting to a sort of preferred solution for that, but there is water yet to still go under the bridge, excuse the pun, around obviously securing the funding and whether there might be any sort of slightly different governance arrangements around that delivery of that program. And the fourth theme is quite closely linked to that one. So there is the possibility that government will be developing special purpose vehicles to progress infrastructure for growth funding, and we're just asking Watercare to be flexible around that and to work with us to progress those as required.
I think that last one you need to add the word financial before vehicles. So.
Before, sorry, what?
New financial vehicles.
Financial vehicles,
because,
yeah.
Right. Watercare.
Yeah.
The Hulse and then Councillor Newman.
Thank you. I just would like to quiz a little bit the active leadership and the sort of the driving force side of things in here. And I just don't want us to overstate this, because we have our council water strategy that we're working on, which is the overarching multi-water strategy, of which Watercare is a part, and their part of it is water in, water out. I think there is a bit of a clash of cultures happening where Watercare are taking the ball and running with it too fast and too far, mm-hmm. and wanting to drive and lead the three water strategy before we're ready for that to be done. So I just think we need to moderate our leadership and driving language in here, because we will do this and Watercare will work with us on it. We need to be firmly in the driving seat around the water strategy, because the problem at the moment is Watercare are racing off to do their own work in a complete parallel universe, and we don't want to reinforce that with what we put in our strategic priorities here. So I think some more work with our Healthy Waters team and Barry Potter and Dean Kempton is needed.
Thank you.
I think that be the general feeling of everyone around here, so it's not just the opinion of one councillor, it's...
Well, I think, Mr. Chair, we do need to be cautious. We don't want to be waffly and wasting time for the board, but we are having some of the old behaviours absolutely surfacing yet again, where the role of council is being completely ignored by Watercare, and, you know, rushing towards taking over and full control of the so-called three waters is not what the expectation is now. And somewhere in here, I think it would be worth, we've mentioned Panuku, the relationship that Watercare should have is with council as a whole and our ongoing development. The relationship with Auckland Transport and Panuku is around stormwater. So, you know, I think we just need to moderate the enthusiasm of Watercare at the moment.
So we have active leadership. I mean, we could be like the Green Party and have active co-leadership.
There's a bit of a wrestle for the wheel. You know, we need to do our water strategy. Watercare then need to fit into the work that's being done. That piece of work, their three water strategy and some of their work is subservient to the wider strategic piece of work that Council's doing about our long-term view of water management. They are not driving, and should not be reading into this, that they're driving the three water strategy and driving the decision on who takes care of stormwater. That's the inference that they've got from some of the wording that we're doing, and it's led them to be embarking on a parallel piece of work that is not correctly timed.
So the message we've got is active engagement and participation by them, but we're leading. I think we can do the wordsmithing later, but that's the sentiment.
Yeah, just on that point, Mr. Chair, I think the strategic and the policy leadership in terms of stormwater remains with council. It's the operational merger that will secure the financial benefits, but we are not passing over the strategic and policy leadership in this area. We're passing over the operational work and implementation.
I think, Mr. Mayor, though, when we say that, we haven't made any decisions about whether we're passing stormwater to Watercare, because Watercare don't actually do nor have much interaction with stormwater. Auckland Transport and Panuku and our Healthy Waters team have a relationship with stormwater. Watercare never has done, nor possibly may do stormwater. We have yet to do that piece of work, and I think that's the piece of work that they're rushing on to do without a sensible long-term view.
Yeah. But we have supported the Section 17A reviews that talk about getting the economies in terms of procurement and maintenance. So it's finding that balance. The policy work, of course, has to come from us. It can't come from the operational side. We're not trying to tell them how to do their job operationally, but we are setting the broad strategy that they need to be part of. They ought not to think that they are determining for the governing body the strategy and broad policy work. That has got to come from us.
But nor have we handed them yet the physical works around stormwater, because that is yet to be decided.
No, but that clearly was the intent of where we can make savings, and $300 million is, you know, it's about the equivalent of the 10-year budget on environmental enhancement. We will want to secure that at the earliest opportunity that it can be properly put in place.
I guess this isn't the time for that discussion, Mr. Chair, because there's an awful lot of questions around that,
to be workshopped.
No.
Just remind members to come through the chair. So possibly paragraph in number one needs a bit of a look at there. That's probably where the way I'm reading it is where.
Yes, we will work on refining that and making sure it reflects what we could.
Councillor Newman.
Yes, thank you. I think that the letter of expectation needs to, and it's probably a comment for the Mayor as much as anything, the letter of expectation needs to address the lack of an agreed funding strategy between Watercare and Veolia, once again, in relation to asset development in particular, in areas that are subject to the franchise agreement in Papakura and in Franklin, because currently there are live-zoned greenfields and there are areas that are going to fall within the forthcoming structure plan area in Drury where there is no agreement between those two parties as to how to deliver that, how to deliver the infrastructure. And the reason for that, depending on who you believe, is that whilst Watercare has the infrastructure growth charge and Watercare has as banker, Veolia does not have that. It has no direct funding relationship with the landowner who needs to deliver the who needs to contribute to the retail infrastructure. Now that's not a too much of an issue, I suppose, in the context of urban Papakura, but given that Drury is one of the single largest areas for greenfield urban development, it has a special purpose vehicle for infrastructure growth. The lack of agreement between the wholesaler and the retailer is glaring, and it hasn't been addressed by Watercare. I mean, I've got a view around, I mean, my view, and you know, this has been televised, my view would be to actually go and request that Watercare look to buy out that franchise. Mm. I just don't see any other way through this, because, and it really is coming home and landing, and it is very difficult, and we can try and address this through letters, but that is the intractable issue that needs to be addressed. And it is specific to one part of Auckland, but the one part of Auckland we're talking about is the one part that's been moved right to the front of our public structure planning. So I'm happy to talk to the Mayor as well about that particular issue. I'm sure that Councillor Cashmore might have a view as well, but this has to be addressed. And given that we're looking to undertake structure planning in March 2018, I can't see how this letter should can go unresolved.
Okay.
No, I think we could add in there something about Watercare looking to do a funding strategy with Veolia in those areas. And can I suggest that perhaps Watercare has a workshop with the governing body to discuss what the issues are around that franchise agreement and the possibility of buying it out?
Yeah, I like that idea.
Because I don't think that's something we can, I don't want to give direction in a letter of expectation like this without having...
Not about the buying out, but...
Yeah. I've got a view, but I have to say that there are some conversations that need to happen offline, and the Mayor needs to be party to that.
Yep.
Yeah.
Constructive solutions to enable the developments to proceed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's been done.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Cooper, Watercare?
No, mine's Panuku.
Okay. Councillor Darby, Watercare?
It's probably going to be in the LOE, and it's probably under additional priorities, is just keeping the attention on the implementation of the water demand management works. I'm sort of taking it as an assumption, but just really noting it. And as we know, that when you have a strong plan to implement demand management, you actually have a plan to alleviate the reliance on high cost infrastructure, and that's the point I would make there. And then under the Western Isthmus Water Quality Improvement Program, and you do refer to funding there, Mr. Chair, we know that the IGCs and the water supply charges are yet to be worked out to pay for the $400 million water care component for that, and so, you know, my question is that arriving at that funding mix on Watercare's part needs to be equitable. But there's even a greater discussion to be held on IGCs for greenfields. So this is a really big and meaty topic, And while it crosses over beyond water care into Matthew, who's grinning there, in his finance division, I think we need to open up this discussion with water care. You know, how do we land equitable funding that does not rely upon existing ratepayers, let alone water users, to subsidise other people's development?
I'll throw a question to Matthew because he hasn't said much. Will that be addressed through the LTP process at all, Matthew?
Through the chair. I think particularly, actually, can I just, a little bit of quick advice, because I think it's useful, and we were pleased to hear this. What's today, Tuesday? So Crown Infrastructure Partners, for the first time, met officially with senior ministers yesterday. So that included Peters, Jones, Robertson, and Twyford. And pleasingly, it all went pretty well. And for all intents and purposes, Simon Allen, who chairs Crown Infrastructure Partners, his board and executive, have been given the green light to proceed, please. We understand that the conversation also involved, reflecting on our encouraging that platform as an opportunity for Central Interceptor as well.
What speed?
Yeah, so look, and yes, lots of talk about too slow, go quicker and think bigger, which we enjoyed hearing that. So there was a lot very promising on that. What I would say here, I think you've got some choices. So one way to go in is kind of open up this big issue around pricing generally. I get that and kind of agree with why you would do that. I would be wary what that might meet with, though, and nothing much might happen. The other way to do this is just to be very clear that we intend to drive hard with enthusiasm on Central Interceptor, and I think what you'll find is the issues that bubble up in resolving that project will cut right across many aspects of how Watercare do business, and possibly including, you know, arrangements with Veolia and the like. So my preference actually is that we just crack on with the projects and we crack on with the new arrangements and see where we fall. And in this letter of expectation, I think you're making it clear enough to Watercare that they need to get alongside that process.
Okay, I'll leave that there. We've got quite a bit to go, so I'm sure the staff have picked it up.
And Councillor Watson, Watercare?
No.
And Councillor Casey, Watercare?
Yeah, I've got one goodie and two baddies. The goodie is, while you're commending Watercare for the Western Isthmus Water Quality Improvement Programme, also can you tell them how we support their continued dialogue with the community? That's a first, and it's really good. They're meeting monthly with the key stakeholders and community groups over that programme, and it's really good. So just a bit of support. The bad ones, the Water Utility Consumer Trust is the vehicle that Watercare uses to allow people struggling to pay their water bills to get some relief, and it just doesn't work. It doesn't work. They keep reporting to us it's not working, but nobody seems fit to change it or make it any better, so I'm just highlighting that as it's not good enough. It's really not good enough. The message doesn't get out there, and it's time we kind of had a look at it or had a discussion about how we can better do that. And the last one, it would be really good if Watercare could stop using water restriction as a means of debt enforcement, and I'll go on saying that until it actually happens. And I'm sure that's got the support of all my colleagues. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Moved, seconded, and all in favour.
Okay, so Watercare seems to be wrapped up. We are moving on to Panuku.
So which of those will get in and which won't? I wondered.
None of those.
Oh. Shut up.
Sorry, AT. We're on to AT.
We've got the AT slide up.
Open transport.
AT.
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 Next one in your agenda is AT. Well, sorry, I'm taking that was the next one in order.
We missed
and we skipped transport.
Oh,
we've done that.
That was at the start. Alistair, yeah. You didn't, you know, how come you didn't say start at the start?
Right.
Okay, Auckland Transport.
All right, so the four key themes here are, number one is about improving the efficiency and effectiveness of the transport network, and wrapped up in that rather bland phrase is more of a focus on network optimization, so alongside some of the big capital investment that's going on, which, you know, can take years to sort of reach its benefits. We're recommending that Auckland Transport focus on network optimization and work closely with the NZTA on this, because obviously the two transport systems kind of interlink, and that's quite critical when it comes to that issue. As well on that is also focusing on improvements to public transport, and there's a little bit more description in the paper about what that means, but essentially making public transport services more attractive, and that might include through things like changes to frequencies or bus lane expansion. And also wrapped up in that sort of overarching theme is about improving the attractiveness of active transport, so walking and cycling. And I will move on to the next one. The second kind of overarching theme is about closer integration with central government transport planning and funding. And obviously there's a lot going on in the space at the moment. The new government is reviewing the government policy statement on transport, and there will be some negotiations and discussion around ATAP. So what we're saying here is that we're kind of asking Auckland Transport to ensure that it has a really good relationship and is working as well as it can, and also to sort of work jointly on things that where there is a shared interest. So for example, with light rail, we would expect that Auckland Transport and NZTA, Auckland Transport is working very closely with NZTA. And there is one other point in that theme around the Auckland Transport, the capital program. So in the current year, Auckland Transport has secured 22% of its capital program through NZTA funding. So Joshua can talk to this in a little bit more detail if required, but So essentially what we're saying is that with the change in government and their sort of they've signalled that they have different transport priorities, we would expect Auckland Transport to be seeking co-funding for all of its projects, and to try and achieve a much better rate than a better rate than 22% at least, and where this would require any policy changes, so changes to the GPS or to funding assistance rates, then we would expect Auckland Transport to work with the council. The third key theme is around safety of the transport system, and this has come up quite a bit sort of in public conversations and in media recently. But I guess what sits behind that is that Auckland Transport hasn't been achieving its road safety statistics and its statement of intent for several years now. So what we're proposing is that the letter of expectation sets out that Auckland Transport needs to undertake an analysis of why this is happening and come back to the council with options to address or reverse this trend. And that would look at all of the implications of those options, obviously. And the fourth key theme is, again, that integrated urban regeneration piece. So obviously transport is really critical to urban development, and Auckland Transport needs to make sure it's working closely with the other CCOs and the parts of council that contribute to urban regeneration. And that's kind of under the sort of stewardship of Pānuku, but there needs to be, I guess the message is that there needs to be integrated governance of those projects. So that's a very quick run through of those.
Councillor Cooper.
No, I'm Pānuku.
Yeah, Pānuku. Sorry, John.
Yeah, just a very quick practical question. That's okay, and it goes under that heading effectiveness of the transport network, the first one. There's some good comments here, statements here. just on a very practical level, like the ones making small improvements to intersections or corridors to make them work better. And I just happen to have a number of instances around my ward where small improvements have been made, but they've made them work worse, i.e. they've created congestion where there wasn't any congestion before. So what does someone like me do in those circumstances with this? Like, what do I go run down to AT and say, look, come up and have a look at Browns Bay and there's a big queue where there's no queue before? What's the practical response that someone like me can make there?
Somebody like you, being a councillor, you have the opportunity of quarterly performance reports, because that really is a performance issue. If they've not made the network better, but in fact made it worse, that is an issue that you should be raising when they come in here for their quarterly performance report. If you cannot wait that long, then I dare say you can work through our teams and we can help you draft a letter and send it to Auckland Transport to get a response directly on those specific issues. But that really is a performance issue.
Go straight to the top. Alistair's made the offer there. So,
Mr. Chair, you're going to lose your quorum.
Yes, I know. I can't do much about it. You know, Councillor Darby, Councillor
Casey,
Councillor Newman.
Just let people come and talk to you, because you've got the final say.
Yeah, but when are we
going
to get
anyway,
to do that?
We're going to keep trucking on.
I'm just saying, unfortunately, the Deputy Mayor and I have got a pre-arranged appointment, ironically, with the new Chief Executive of Auckland Transport.
Oh.
But, we have to be gone in about no later than 10.
PM.
10 o'clock tonight.
10 minutes.
Oh, sorry.
It's a quorum 11.
Which one do you need through?
We've got a
right to him here.
Yeah. You're right.
So let's just keep moving, but I'm letting you know that in advance.
Because Phil and Bill are gone.
Yeah.
Still 11. I can't count.
Okay, we are still.
Brains are stopped.
Now, let's just clarify this. Excluding the Mayor and the Deputy Mayor, is everyone else able to say?
Yes. God, but we've got to have 11, so we won't have.
Only if you keep this moving at a reasonable pace.
There's 11 when you two go, Your Worship.
10, actually, 11. Isn't it? The two of us are going.
Yeah.
Finance performance, so David's here.
11.
It's
11. There's 11.
Oh.
4, 6,
This
eight.
Is not good for the Finance Committee if we count.
11, yes. Yeah. 11.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yes. I'm working on the governing body, you know that, eh?
You're not allowed to go, David.
Okay. Again, you have to make up the quorum.
All right, okay, we obviously are.
Keep going.
So slippy, missing me.
Keep going.
Right, Councillor Darby.
Well, on that note, I hope somebody is watching this live streaming, because it's a complete embarrassment that so many people are absent. I can understand that the Mayor and Deputy have to go to things.
Yeah.
It is embarrassing.
And I'll be here to allow them to go to things. But look what we're discussing here. The LOEs for 6 CCOs, and we've got councillors who are AWOL. I'm really irritated by this. I'm reluctant to go through this, because I think we have to. I might just take these matters to the Mayor's office and discuss them. It's the only way to do this. We can't do this justice here now. We don't have the time. I can't start this up. We don't have the time. I'm going to take these matters that I've got written down to the Mayor's office. But Mr. Chair, I hope people are watching this live stream and can see the gaps here. Usual suspects.
Yep. Cause trouble, then leave.
Mr. Chair, I don't like those sort of personal comments. The people have got all manner of reasons to be other places. So make the statement, but none of the little snide, dismissive remarks, if that's possible, please. That doesn't help
that
anyone.
Very
it's okay.
Yeah.
I was going to say I thought that was overstepping the mark, but hear what Councillor Darby is saying. Councillor Casey.
I've got two things under the safety aspect. One's good, one's bad. The travel-wise programme that Auckland Transport does is the answer to it. When we're encouraging them to address the high crash rate, travel-wise, there was a recent do at the Cloud with 650 kids, 96 awards. That's what Auckland Transport should be investing in. That's what we should be supporting them investing in. The bad bit is the safety at level crossings. I don't think that message is getting out at all, and I'm not sure who's delivering it and how. And given the little work we're doing in grade separation, we need to get that message out. So I'd like somebody to kind of give me some assurances on that. And that's it. That took less than 1 minute, by the way.
Yep. Well done. That was noted, but do you remember when the electric trains came in, Auckland Transport did forewarn that fatalities would possibly double through the quieter electric trains. So
yeah, but we need to get the message out.
Look, I think that you've been diplomatic with your comments. In most work categories with Auckland Transport, there is a cap on NZTA funding, and this is resulting in a proportion of expenditure that is fully funded by Auckland Transport, the ratepayers, in effect, increasing. It is very important that Auckland Transport is able to negotiate a reasonable and increasing contribution from NZTA for road maintenance, and where they can't, it's very important that they reveal where there are disagreements between AT and NZTA, because this needs to be taken up at a governance level too, because if Auckland Transport continues to persist with trying to manoeuvre budgets, because it can fund CapEx, fine, but if it can't fund OPEX, we need to know that, because that needs to be a point of advocacy that the Mayor takes up, because otherwise we have our best transport asset, which is actually our road network, which just continually becomes undermined at a time when the infrastructure is under more and more pressure because of the increased demand for it through growth. So I would like Auckland Transport to be very transparent around the gaps in funding because of, in my view, shortchanging from NZTA. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
That is the intention of that last paragraph. To force that.
And you're being very, very polite about it, but it's very important. I mean, I've got a contract for Southwest Urban Road Renewals, and we are way behind where we should be, and in part because NZTA won't fund it. And every time NZTA closes the Southern Motorway at Papakura at night, so that they continue with the motorway widening, all the traffic rumbles up Elliott Street. And the Great South Road, which has some very, very weak subgrade in it, and this is something that ends up falling on the ratepayers.
What I heard was
Auckland Transport, any further relevant comments? Right, we'll go quickly to 18. After Mayor and Deputy,
RFA, I'd quite like. Four. I think Councillor Watson's got something to say about that.
Okay, let's go to RFA. And we'll just try and.
Yep, so the three key areas for RFA are around essentially consolidating their operations, sort of acknowledging that there is limited funding for capital development. So just trying to maximise commercial return. There's also a point in there about ensuring that the art gallery can sustain its operations into the future. There's obviously been some recent sort of coverage of that issue. The second point is around the regional stadia strategy. Essentially, we're saying that there's enough uncertainty that we think it is wise to pause the development of that.
But it was paused.
I won't say any more. And the third is around support for the cultural heritage review. So just making sure it inputs into that, and recognising that it may mean changes for RFA's business when it finally reaches its conclusion.
Well, good. Right, Councillor Watson.
Yeah, no, I think you've answered my question, and it basically just goes to translating what that means. Number two, and that is basically the stadium strategy will pause until such times as the future with Eden Park and a national stadium becomes apparent, both of which we have limited if no control over. Is that my reading of that correctly?
Yeah. At a certain point, our hand will be forced when a decision has to be made to spend large, large sums of money to keep Eden Park open, and then councillors will have to think whether they want to do that. And my preference is obviously not to put money into something that, under the current operating circumstances, loses the equivalent of at least $9 million a year, which is the money they don't put aside for depreciation. But right now we have no money either to do what the Eden Park Trust Board wants, which is $750 million to totally reform it and bring it up to standard, or build an alternative national stadium on the down by the Spark Arena site. That's probably $1 to $1.5 billion. Desirable to do it, but we don't have the money to do it, so it can't be done. We would have to look at private sector money. We would have to look at national government money if we were to have another Rugby World Cup or a Commonwealth Games. But until those developments happen, a whole lot of other developments don't necessarily make sense to bring forward. You know, yes, we can't play full cricket matches at Eden Park because it's not international ICC approved. But are you really going to put a lot of money into Western Springs for five-day matches that have very low attendances? Or are you then going to take one-day cricket matches off Eden Park, which would make even Eden Park even less financially viable? So there's a whole lot of things that need to happen in an interconnected way. And until we can make progress on the major decision, then there is less pressing need to do the other side of it. That is a discussion I'm currently having with RFA. They are not happy with that position, but you know, short of the tens of millions of dollars that we need for that stadium strategy, as a minimum amount, it's not likely to happen.
Thank you. Councillor Casey.
Yeah, I've never felt a pressing need to do a stadium strategy. I don't think any of us ever have. I don't know whose pressing need it was. I think it was RFA's. Well done, John. Just a reminder that Eden Park is a business nestled in a ward in my area, a residential ward. My things are two.
Used to be a farm.
The first is... I still remember the meeting we had with the board of RFA and the position of this council relative to free and low-cost events as being an essential part of what we do and what the public love us for. And I keep raising it, and I'm still not sure. You keep saying it comes as letters of expectation. Is this where it goes? Because I'd love to see that in the air. I think we need to tell them that we do want you to save costs, but not at the expense of free and low-cost activities that you provide for our population. Everyone say aye. Against
I think they anyway, we'll just get a clarification here, because I think they do...
Yeah.
They are aware of their responsibilities. Where they come back is they say, well, that's fine, but we've got this cut-off point where the financial constraints are too great. So,
but we can tell them what we want through the chair. This is what I'm saying. This is our chance to say that we think this is one of the really good things you do.
Sure. We can tell them what they want, and then as an independent corporate board, they will come back and say, well, we just don't have the money to do any more than we're doing now. So anyway, I'll let Alistair respond.
A couple of points to that. One, there's actually a performance measure in the LTP about the number of community days or events that they have to have at their regional facilities. And the second point is exactly like the Chair said, and Chris Brooks has reiterated whenever he's been in front of this committee that, yes, they get their obligation, they really want to have those free events, but there does become a point where they simply run out of money for them. Now, where that point is, I'd suggest, is a matter for discussion during the LTP process, when the, as I think Councillor Hulse refers to it, the real budget will be discussed next year.
I've got some questions, but I'll just keep them for
now. Just see if Councillor Casey's got any follow-up.
My last one, which is the usual one for RFA, is that I'd like to be able to walk into every facility that Council owns, that's managed for us by RFA, including all the zoo and everything else, and recognise the Auckland Council funding that supports it. And at the moment, it doesn't happen. Mm. And, you know, this is year 7.
True.
And what I keep getting back in response is we're rolling them out as the old signs, whatever. It's not, it really isn't good enough, so you'll just keep me doing this forevermore.
I believe they're branding the new elephant with the Pahuta Kawa.
Tattooing the red flower.
Easy. Come on, we're nearly there. Settle.
Okay, right.
Yeah, that's Ian.
We have Councillor Hills.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm slowly losing the will to live. But the RFA, it's good that you've mentioned the funding in there, but we need to address it for the art gallery. It's there, but it's not there, like it's mentioned, which is good, but I'm not really sure what is exactly saying. The other thing is, both RFA and ATEED, and I'm not sure if the priorities are not all in here, but it says nothing about celebrating the city, promoting the city, making the city exciting, marketing the city, doing all the things that both of those CCOs are supposed to be doing, bringing people here. It's not explicitly here, but maybe it's going to be in the body of the letter. I know it's going to be wider, but it's sort of not saying the exciting things we're wanting them to also do. It's a little bit structural.
Yeah, I think that's sort of part of their core purpose and reason for being. I think it's taken as a given, but
so would Auckland Transport, which say things about public transport and safety. So those are their core business too. But it's what we want, or I assume what we want their kind of focuses to be on. It's a little bit just bricks and mortar for two agencies that are supposed to be the exciting arms of the city.
Yep. Be exciting and attract people on a limited budget.
Yeah, but we, this is what I mean. We have to talk about it because we're funding them to do those things.
Yep.
Even on a limited budget, they're still marketing $110 million worth of tickets, RFA, and stadiums and venues and performance spaces and events. So we're either doing it or we're not. So even on the limited budget, they're still armed to do those things. AT's still armed to do the visitor attraction and the big events and everything too. So I just want to make sure that those are included still in their priorities. Otherwise, what are we doing?
Hey, we've got... Anyone else on RFA?
Yes, but I'll keep mine straight to the mayor.
All right, we will
minimise the time.
We will go back to 18, was it?
Should I do this one?
Yeah.
Yep.
Just point out that I think it's morally reprehensible that Auckland doesn't have a quality test cricket venue, but that's just my prejudices.
Here,
here.
Oh,
well.
Do have one.
Well, if they want to pay for it.
I'll move quickly on. ATEED, I think the key message here is that actually they're in the middle of reviewing what their focus areas are, responding to the economic challenges of Auckland, and that's part of the LTP discussion. So I guess the key message there is to keep working with Auckland Council on that. We've made a point about leveraging infrastructure investments. I guess the point there, and it's a bit like the integration of sort of regeneration activities, that most bang for council buck is likely to be where we're spending other money in our priority areas around the region. And I guess the final point there is getting the most from major events. Obviously, we've got APEC and hopefully the America's Cup coming up. So putting a real emphasis on leveraging those events should be a focus of ATEED's.
Alistair, missing is no reference to their immediate challenge of working with the accommodation sector to change the governance structure of what we're doing in regards to events. There's no, that surely is a priority to bed that one down, and it's not necessarily ongoing, well, it is ongoing, but it's something that needs to be done well.
We can reference that, and a report will actually be coming to the governing body on Thursday about that.
All good. Right, we have Councillor Cooper.
Yeah. So that's Panuku. Yeah. I've said it about 10 times. Sorry,
my page was open at Panuku, and I.
Oh, sorry, this has still got 18 up here.
Councillor Darby.
Thank you. Briefly, the one gap for me here, and I think it's an area that ATEED want to focus on, but we don't. We re-emphasise again what they're doing well. What they need to focus on is economic development. And my question to you, Alistair and team, is: are we assuming that they're doing really well in the ED space? Because my observation is they're doing really well in events and in tourism, but they need us saying we need to lift your game in the ED space.
Look, I think that's tied up in that first point, reviewing what their focus areas are in that ED space. They're having a look at the moment about where they can best intervene to actually get the most out of economic development. But point taken, I think that needs to be emphasised that is the area that they need to put greatest focus on, because like you say, tourism and major events are going relatively well, so we can put that emphasis in there.
So it's interesting, Chair. So if you read the point one, yes, it covers it, but the narrative for me just doesn't reflect what ED is and where we're missing.
Yeah. And it all reflects as though ATEED have got to be working with the council, and yet ATEED have consistently come back and said, look, the big problem is central government, who don't want to devolve economic development by and large. It's something they're starting to listen when it comes to Auckland, but they really don't want to devolve too much of what they do in Wellington. So should that not reference there? I mean, it's like you're not making progress because you're not working with us, but they keep coming back with the same answer.
Fair point. I think the reference to working with council there is actually as part of their review about what their focus areas should be, agreeing those with council. But yes, in order to deliver effectively, they do need to work with central government. So
I mean, it is a no-brainer. Councillor Darby and I went with the mayor up to Guangzhou, and it's quite clear. I mean, Wellington was there, and we were there, and seemed to get on the personal level. But I wouldn't say I was impressed that they were working totally hand in hand.
It wasn't an absolutely positively good relationship.
Councillor Philippine.
Questions around the focus areas. There's a review of ATEED's focus areas. What will they be? The other question is, I'll be interested to find out the areas that will require reduction in funding, and also the new measures to be developed to align with new focus areas. So when will the focus areas or new focus areas be coming up, and what they will be, and who it will be negotiated with the focus areas. And again, the measures that fall out of that in regards to the focus area. So just questions around that, Alistair, please.
Yeah, the timing of all this is the draft statements of intent will be coming to you. They're due by 1 March, and we've actually scheduled a workshop between the ATEED board and the governing body in either March or April to discuss that. Now, their draft statement of intent should reflect these new focus areas that they're working up now. So that will be the opportunity to discuss with them then what those focus areas will be before you, as the governing body, give back to ATEED your shareholder feedbacks on their draft statement of intent. So it will be those discussions will happen in that statement of intent, sort of LTP finalisation process, sort of March, April, May next year.
Okay. And last question around Destination Auckland. I know it's not in there. I'm assuming that'll be part of the, and we had Destination Auckland at our workshop. So, I mean, they're still developing that. Mm-hmm. So I'm assuming that'll be part of the new focus areas.
Yes, they're refreshing their Destination Auckland plan as we speak.
It went to a workshop. Environmental and Community Committee workshop, so this is why I ask. And I know it's not specifically in here, but the question is around, is that also part of the the focus areas and looking in light of what Councillor Darby said.
Yep, that will remain a focus of ATEED, and even more so because that's now 50% funded by the targeted rate, so they're required to spend the money on that.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else relating to ATEED?
Yeah, just support what Councillor Darby said, and because I mean ATEED is responsible for Māori economic development as well, and I'm a bit concerned about the lack of what's been coming out of that. So I'm also concerned that if it's even further reduction and doing nothing. So yeah, I just wanted to support what Councillor Darby's been saying.
Okay, right, we'll move straight on to Panuku.
My comments stand on the AT. My comments on RFA were the same as AT, to go back.
Thank you. So Panuku, the three kind of key themes that we've included here, or as proposed, are included in the letter of expectation. The first is around possible central government housing interventions. So the new government, going back to when it was in opposition, has signalled that it intends to facilitate further housing supply through urban development authorities. And we obviously, there isn't any kind of public clarity about what that might look like. But given that Auckland has the most pressing housing issues, it is probable that any changes that come out of that will involve Panuku in some way, possibly in a way that's material to it. So what we're saying there is that Panuku should be flexible and responsive, and just noting that that, you know, will need to play out a bit more over the coming months, depending on what the government's intentions are and what the council, any agreements the council might make with them. The second is about that theme in that kind of common theme about integrated urban regeneration. So it says in the discussion actively participate in, but it that really should say lead in the integrated governance of urban regeneration, as that's Panuku's role. They have a mandate from the council to facilitate urban regeneration and work across the other CCOs and the council to achieve that. So that that is one thing, but obviously that will the level to which that's achievable will be dependent on the outcome of the long-term plan. And the third and last priority for them is for proposed priority for Panuku is about again leveraging the benefits of those major events. And so just to kind of expand on what Alistair said in relation to ATEED, it's about making sure that this works well with the council's plans for the city centre and waterfront, and that there is a sort of enduring benefit for Aucklanders in those events. Making sure that, you know, it's not just about the events themselves, but that we there is some kind of ongoing benefit.
Councillor Cooper.
Thank you. So my comments, and it's a shame, I did want the Mayor to hear it because I imagine it comes from his office in general, directing Alistair and his team. I just think that some of that first point and the second point could actually actively cross over each other. I am very worried about us directing Panuku to be basically flexible to the government, which could at the same time undermine what we're doing with our unlock areas.
Totally agree.
There's no money for unlock. It's completely predicated on how much money we can, you know, realise out of the developments we want to do. It's only, you know, really we've got some local boards that have put a lot of money in, and even that's not enough. We're trying to work on market attractiveness here. Some of these unlock areas are already in high deprivation areas, which drives down market attractiveness, sadly, and drives down good retail. And so for me, we're trying to redress the imbalance to restore it to kind of middle New Zealand. We're not trying to gentrify, we're just trying to get back a bit of balance an area's already got a lot of Housing New Zealand, and I'm just concerned that us expecting Panuku to be nimble risks that unlock work being unsuccessful and not realising the cash, really a trade-off to support government initiatives, not our own. And that's not part of our current policy. So those are my concerns, and I, you know, this is not trying to undo, but I mean, if the government want to do their stuff, let them do their stuff, good. But I don't want to sacrifice what we've fought hard for to realise as somebody else's goals, you know. So that's my biggest concern about basically telling Panuku to do something that we don't even know what the hell they're supposed to be doing in the first place. I don't want my community, and I'm not just talking about Northcote, Onehunga, but Henderson, we have fought so hard, and basically the local board have sacrificed all the transport and LDI money for the next 3 years to help support market attractiveness. And if we screw it up, you know, so I don't know what you're going to do with this, because it's the mayor's direction, obviously. I will bring it up in my little appointment with him tomorrow, but I've only got 15 minutes. So I want to, that's my biggest concern. I want our Unlock Transform support projects to work. Yep. And I do think this can cut into it.
So Sarah and Alistair, you really need to take this on board, because I know the chairs of the three main committees, we are going to be very unhappy, and I think there's many of us around here, if Greenfield starts to get the light from central government and then we're expected to pour our resources there, which would totally undermine what has been our special priority program and our Panuku program, which they've come back to reinforce. So we need to be very careful how you do that, because Panuku should be also influencing central government on our behalf, as we will be, as to where we see priorities for housing.
Yes.
But we've already spent a lot of money in some areas, including where the government is. I'll give you Lynn as an example. If they're not going to then go and support New Lynn after putting in $150 million or $450 million, then what a waste of investment.
Exactly.
What a pure waste of investment when it's already been done. And there are examples all around the area, let alone Tamaki or whatever, racing
Henderson,
off to
look
do other things.
Station.
So I'm giving you, because I'm reading the nods and everything there, you need to be very careful how you do this, and it's not the government wagging the dog.
Right,
it's okay.
The message is Brownfields as council is what Panuku was set up to do.
Yep.
And that, yes, things will be changing with central government, but that will, we collectively, being council in Panuku, will have to wait to see what the council wants, and council will determine the response to that.
Yeah,
but I think, as Councillor Cooper's pointed out, using the word flexible, responsive,
flexible?
It kind of reads,
how far
so
are they going to bend
and
over?
Working with the council and clarifying its role, well, I mean,
sorry.
Need to be careful how we...
It's not too flexible. Okay, so that, yeah, that obviously needs quite a bit of work, but we will.
We'll roll back the YouTube tape on this and get you a message when we get back to our desks and craft some words.
Because you're aware that in the LTP for consultation we've just gone out and done, it's really pretty silent on Panuku, and Panuku and placemaking and town centres is going to have to fight like hell in stage two. Whether it's the ones that aren't even in the support category, but it's going to be a big fight. We seem to have won the fight on the local board initiatives, but some of them, it's much bigger than a local board issue. It's a placemaking issue for us, and needless to say, it all sheets back to the Auckland plan. So we have Councillor Darby.
Yeah, look, the I think it's, in some ways it is reflected in the one, but there needs to be an emphasis on Panuku achieving strategic outcomes in additional to its financial. Maybe we've sort of alluded to that. And I guess that key example is affordable housing. So it's not just affordable housing. Yes, we want to draw a focus to financial outcomes, but there are strategic outcomes that are required.
And just to further, you know, and affordable housing is an important part of it, but it's also trying to actually get the market. They were talking about the government coming in and doing this and that and all that sort of stuff, and we don't want to actually just end up with basically a high concentration of Housing New Zealand overwhelming a suburb or a town centre, because we want the market to be responding to give that cross-section of housing. So I think there needs to be some reference there to, it's not just Housing New Zealand or central government housing interventions, it's actually the market's interventions as well, and that's a key thing we were trying, because we're not going to be building housing. We will help facilitate. Right, anyone else on Panuku? Right, we're down to one, but there are other items, so don't rush off, folks. All can count.
Can't anyway, there's 11 here, so well. I've just got my local board meeting. I will wait until we finish this before I go.
No one can go yet.
I'm just saying. That's what I said.
Have 11 now. Auckland Council investments.
I'll wait until we finish.
Just very
simple
quick.
As that.
I think, look, we don't need to go through that. But but it's all there. It's quite plain, I think. Auckland International Airport. We talk about, we would need to know about their capital raising. We don't make any mention that we kind of would like to know about their public transport cooperation regards public transport needs, etc. through the airport, because it seems as though we've almost never tried to negotiate with them to say you should be paying for X, Y, and Z. Why should we be paying for it to uplift their value? And of course we own 20% of it, and then we get a bit of uplift as well, but bottom line is the shareholders that are getting that uplift from us investing, that perhaps they're not investing in public transport. So I don't know whether that seemed to be a relevant thing that we should be. Why would they give you a concession?
Mr. Chair,
no incentive.
I've asked them.
There's a big program that's just being rolled out at the airport now.
With
bus priority measures, the whole lot.
Do we need to re-emphasise that in their...
I think Auckland Transport and NZTA and the airport company are right on top of it.
All good. Any other questions on investments?
I'll speak to the airport anyway around their
plan. So we're back to some resolutions right at the start. They have been moved by myself. By who?
Me.
Moved by me and seconded by Councillor Simpson. Put the resolutions. You'll see the change to the resolutions there. I'll put A, B, C, and D. All those in favour?
Aye.
Aye. All good. Right. Thank you very much. Thank you, Alistair. Thank you, Sarah. Okay. We're now moving on to item number 13.
You're all collectively losing the will to live, I'm sensing. Do you want me to introduce this or?
No.
Give us a will to live.
So we just, I'm happy to move to authorise the Chief Executive to act as Auckland Council shareholder representative.
I'm happy to. Oh, I just put it
Councillor Newman, second.
Second.
Yep.
There are no questions?
No.
Put the resolution.
Wait a minute.
Which option?
On B.
Oh,
didn't get B. No. Can someone just explain B? Whatever Alistair says. So what should we do? Execute a written shareholders thing or vote on Auckland Council's behalf?
I just tried.
Surely it's vote on Auckland. What's your advice?
The only difference with TRC is we jointly own that with the Crown, so we can't unilaterally decide to not have a shareholders annual general meeting, and we're waiting for the Crown to decide which option it wants. So we're covering all bases there by saying Stephen can either sign a resolution in lieu of an AGM or he can vote on our behalf at an AGM.
Depending upon the Crown's decision.
I thought we had to choose either or, sorry.
Councillor Cooper has moved, Councillor Newman has seconded. All those in favour?
Aye.
Against?
Number we up to now.
Right.
I'll move 14.
We have 14,
option one.
And we have Neil here, I believe.
Rod.
Rod. Okay, welcome, Rod.
Move option one.
You got 2 minutes.
Okay. Please.
For the whole meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through the Chair, this has actually been to the full governance group and it was approved at the governing body. It's come back here for funding. It's around speeding up our asset renewal and getting more investment in our front end of our asset condition and our investigation and design work, so we can actually deliver our capital delivery program back to the local boards. It went through the local board governance framework, who supported this option. That's why it came back to the full governing body, and what we're here today is seeking the funding to fast track.